Hello and welcome to the editorial analysis of the Hindu. Today we shall be discussing the editorial of the 10th of August. So coming to the first article. Incisive interventions that blunt the RTI's edge. As obvious, the context here is with regards to the amendments that have taken place in the context of the RTI Act. We have discussed articles on this in the past also. So just a few newer points that are coming our way in this particular context. But yes, it is an important topic, primarily because this amendment bill is what is going to get passed. We all know that the parliament at present is what is ruled by a major party. So in that context, the editorial becomes important. Now, first and foremost, the editorial is talking about the meaning of democracy in India. Here the editorial is raising the question that is democracy in India only about adult franchisee, the universal concept of universal adult franchisee where voting is what is done after 18 years. Is democracy all about that, that once we are 18 we go and vote and through popular vote a government comes to power? You should all know that democracy was never about that, and still democracy is not about that. Democracy is about so much more. It is about a continuous involvement of the citizens in daily decision making. It is about the rights that we all have. We have the right of freedom of expression. We have the right to life and liberty. We have the right of equal opportunity. All of this is what is democracy, and this is what has to be protected in the system, which was what was done by the RTI, and that is what is the first analysis. Next, the editorial is discussing about the RTI. I have several times talked about it, and I would still assert that RTI has been a landmark legislation in India. This is one of the few legislation that has come from, instead of a top-down approach, this is what has come from the people, and it has gone from bottom up. Now this is what was that was generated after a struggle of almost 20 years by the Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathan. We all know that it is what came into existence in the year 2005, and this is what came into existence after several debates which took place both by the parliament as well as by the parliamentary committees. I'm sorry, my tab is not working well today, so you might have some problems in reading about it, so I apologize for that. Definitely we are in the process of correcting our tab as of now, so please adjust for this one particular video. So coming back to the topic about the RTI, that is one issue, that this is what was debated by the parliamentary committee as well as by the parliament. So if this was the amount of debates that took place in the context of the RTI, then why is it that its amendments are not being focused upon so much? So that is the first analysis. Another thing is that this act has been very much transformative for our country. The issue with the amendments is that these amendments are what are being passed without any scrutiny of the parliamentary committee. This is what is decreasing the governance system. This is what is reducing the transparency in the system. These amendments are what are threatening the system, is what has been talked about. Another issue is that in these amendments, the basic issue is with regards to the terms and tenures of the information commissions and the commissioners. Now, what is basically going to happen is that the salaries as well as the term, the tenure, is what is now going to be decided not by law but by the executive. By simple executive regulation, their salaries can be decided, their term of office can be decided, and this is what is definitely going to impact their autonomy, and this is a negative amendment. This is going to impact the functioning of the information commissioners, who are expected to act almost as a judicial body. So that is what is going to happen. A dilution of their powers is definitely going to happen. Some benefits of RTI is also what have been talked about. These kind of examples, I always welcome them, because these examples are what we can easily represent or write as case studies which will fetch us more marks. For example, in the year 2000, from the year 2006 to 2010, what happened in Delhi was that 700 crore rupees, so please remember this sum also, 700 crore, because when you give a case study, you have to give some details. So what happened during this time was that 700 crore rupees was what was diverted from scheduled caste, the project for the development of the scheduled caste towards Commonwealth. And this is an information that was extracted out of the RTI. So that was one case study of benefit. Also, more recently, there has been an expose by Rohini Mohan about the horrifying processes of the foreign tribunals in Assam. Also, whether you talk about any scam, be it the 2G scam or the coal scam, in all of these scams, it is the RTI which has played a major role. So that is another important aspect about the RTI. That is what is relevant. Coming to the next article, before I shift to the next article, I would just like to tell you that RTI will be one of the most important topics for this year, even if it doesn't ask you directly about the amendments, because it is late for asking that, and the mains is just due. But what can definitely come is an analysis on the RTI. So that is where you can take off these positives of the RTI that we are discussing, and that is how you have to bring about an analysis, and that is how you have to use it. So that's about this particular article. Coming to the next article, the State of the Union. Now basically, this is context with regards to the recent speech that Prime Minister has given on Jammu and Kashmir. This was a speech for 37 minutes, and indeed this was an important speech. It came at a very, very important moment, and that is why this speech is important. The editorial is on this particular speech. Now, the first analysis is with regard to some irresponsible speeches. A very, very shameful aspect that has come to the fore is that during such a sensitive time, on such a sensitive topic, some leaders are making claims and shameful claims that now they are going to go and bring the Jammu and Kashmir women and they're going to get them married to the boys in their own states. These kind of statements further fuels the fire that is burning in Jammu and Kashmir. The tendencies of separatism is what is further fueled. So first analysis is with regards to absolute condonement of these irresponsible speeches, which should come from the highest echelon of India, from the Prime Minister himself. That should take place. So that is the first issue. Another issue which is important is with regards to the assurances that the Prime Minister himself has offered, which is somehow assuaging to the people of Jammu and Kashmir. The Prime Minister has very, very importantly assured that the conversion of Jammu and Kashmir to a UT is what is very, very temporary. This is what is definitely going to be restored back to statehood once normalcy is what is restored in Jammu and Kashmir. Also, he has assured of participatory elections which will take place at the earliest. He has assured that growth will take place in Jammu and Kashmir. Employment will increase. Commerce will increase. Opportunities will increase. So these are the assurances which the people have been given by the Prime Minister himself. Indeed, this is something that should calm down the separatist tendencies in Jammu Kashmir, the emotions in Jammu Kashmir which are at a rise as of now. So that is one analysis which has been offered. Another very, very important analysis which I found in the article is that the editorial is discussing as to what is the reason of separatism in Jammu and Kashmir. It is discussing that is the reason for separatism Article 370, or is it the erosion of Article 370 that has been the reason of separatism, is what has to be debated in Jammu and Kashmir. The government says that it is Article 370 which it was basically something that was responsible for separatism, but clearly that is what has been refuted in the editorial, and it is saying that as per trends what has been seen is that whenever the government has tried to dilute Article 370, what has happened is that there has been tendencies of separatism. So that is what has been highlighted. So another analysis is with regards to the issue of national integration and diversity. This is important because the government in its defense has said that it is in the interest of national integration that the government is going ahead with this kind of a decision of making Jammu and Kashmir a part of India. That Article 370 has been done away with. But the editorial is highlighting that it is not that in the name of national integrity we are going to enforce a cultural homogeneity. That cannot happen. We have to respect diversity. We have to respect the fact that not all the states will be same. Some states might be more different from the others, and that is how integration will be maintained. So that is another analysis which has been offered here. Also, the editorial is offering us a sort of a solution where it is saying that a representative government and full statehood at the most urgent is what is required for peace in Jammu and Kashmir. So that is what has been talked about in this article. Indeed, this is what is in continuation to Jammu and Kashmir issue. The Prime Minister's speech is what I would recommend all of you all to hear. This is a very, very important issue. Will go a long way in UPSC. Questions will be asked on this. So from that particular context, this will be important. Also, Prime Minister's speech will help you build more clear ideas and more clear opinions on this particular topic. Even for interview, this will be a very, very hot topic. So that is what is the relevance of this particular article. And that's about our discussion today. I thank you all for watching the video.